today, you know, we are having the last in our series, and it is my distinct pleasure to introduce our speaker in this distinguished series of lectures celebrating Ramlila Appreciation Month. And our speaker, he used to play Ramlila as a child in Ajitgarh in the rural landscape of Rajasthan. He completed a master's in business management at the University of Rajasthan, acquiring several gold medals and awards along the way. He's a member of the prestigious Company Secretaries of India. Our speaker is also a writer and a poet. He has written Mongolia, the Land of Blue Skies, published in 2007. He's written prolifically on foreign policy and related issues. His latest book, Unraveling the Mysteries of Life, Modern Science and Ancient Wisdom, was launched at UWE in May 2014. It's a book that explores human life through the lens of ancient Indian wisdom and modern science. Our speaker is fluent in French and Spanish, among the various Indian languages, and he has traveled widely. He joined the Indian Foreign Service in 1981 and served in places like Belgium, Bangladesh, Bahrain, Mongolia, France, Hungary, Bosnia, Herzegovina, places we only see on the television with war and fighting, and the Philippines. He's currently assigned to Trinidad and Tobago as a High Commissioner of India and accredited to Grenada, Montserrat, and the Commonwealth of Dominica. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the final speaker for Ramlila Appreciation Month and to invite him to the podium, His Excellency Sri Gauri Shankar Gupta, High Commissioner of India.
Sitaram to everyone. I am amongst the people who know Ramlila and Ramayana very well. So it would be a sort of test for me. To begin with, let me thank profoundly the University of Trinidad and Tobago and its provost Fazal Ali for inviting me to address this gathering this evening, and also for commemorating what we call Ramlila Appreciation Month every year. It's indeed a great tradition, and I'm thankful to UTT and all the actors who have played part in instituting this for this great initiative. I'm thankful to Pandita Indrani, who just spoke before me. She has been deeply involved into Ramlila. She has done research. She has seen many Ramlilas in India and has done, in fact, a lot of writing on Ramlila-related issues. She has delivered a lot of talks. So I'm thankful to you, Panditaji, for getting me involved into today's event. And of course, the Professor Liverpool, who is head of the department, who is instrumental in supervising and monitoring this entire process. I'm also thankful to Lana, who was here just a little while ago, who has played a very active role in this whole process of introducing Ramlila or reintroducing Ramlila to the people of Trinidad and Tobago, and particularly the younger generation of the country. As I told you, I am amongst the people who know Ramlila and Ramayana much better, but I will try to speak something on this occasion today. If we go back to the history of India, the two great epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata, they constitute the soul of what we call Indian civilization. If you take these epics out of Indian civilization, it will become hollow. These are also the epics which in the living memory of mankind are the longest living epics. Without any break in time, their storage, their all the enactments given in there have been forming part of human life for the last more than 7-8 centuries, depending on how you go back in time. And in that sense, Ramayana is the oldest epic because it is much older than Mahabharata. In fact, in Mahabharata, there is reference to Ramayana. And in Bhagavad Gita also, when Krishna refers, I think it's chapter 12th, he refers to Rama as one of the greatest holder of bow and arrow. So, Ramayana is much older than Mahabharata. And this is an epic which has influenced human civilization across the globe. There are more than 40 countries in the world where the stories of Ramayana have existed and are existing in one form or the other. You go to China, you go to Mongolia, you go to all the 10 countries of ASEAN, Philippines included, Philippines, Malaysia, Brunei, the Indochina, that is Vietnam, Cambodia, Myanmar. Then you go to Central Asia, whole of Central Asia. Then you go to Indian Ocean countries, Mauritius and some other islands in that area. And then you come to Caribbean. In all these areas of the world, story of Ramlila, story of Ramayana has existed for long, long time. In fact, if you go to Indonesia, you find these old temples. You go to Cambodia, you find these old temples. So this is one epic which has existed in living form in the human civilization longest ever. I don't know any other epic that has existed for that long in the living form. Now, before I go to the message of Ramayana and Ramlila, I would like to start with Bhagavad Gita. And there's a reason for that, which I will explain. So there is a sloka in chapter 4th of Bhagavad Gita, which Krishna said, Yada yadai dharmasya glanir bhavati bharat abhyuttatanam dharmasya tadatmanam srajyamaham paritranaya sadhunam vinasaya chaduskritam dharm sansthapnarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. The meaning of this sloka is that whenever there is depreciation of good in this world, yada yadai dharmasya glanir bhavativa, whenever there is depreciation of dharma, depreciation of righteousness, depreciation of good, and when the good people are attacked by the evil forces, then the good appears in the form of human being to re-establish the good and to destroy the evil. Now, this is one of the facets of Ramayana. Because Ram appeared in Treta Yuga, as we call it, according to the historical records, to do precisely the same. According to the writings, he came into the human form to destroy a lot of evil forces which were around in that time and to re-establish the order, to re-establish what we call the righteousness, the morality, the ethics, the human conduct. And that is how the story begins. Now, Ramayana has its beginning with sage Valmiki. But the story happened much earlier. Sage Valmiki wrote it. It is estimated that he wrote around 5th century BC. And the time, you know, estimates differ from person to person. But the story did not begin with sage Valmiki. The story had happened before And he wrote it down in the Sanskrit language that time. And then subsequently it has been written in the form of Ramcharitmanas by Tulsidas. It has also been written separately in Tamil language. It has been written in Malayalam, in Telugu, in all these languages. Then it has been translated into many languages around the world, including the Chinese, Bhasa Indonesia, Arabic, Persian, some of the other languages of Central Asia in different forms. When you translate, you capture part of it, you lose part of it because, as we call, lost in translation, part of it is lost. Now that reminds me an incident, when I was posted in the Philippines. There was a meeting of the ASEAN foreign ministers in Manila. And those countries were looking for a play, a cultural event, which is common to all the ASEAN countries. And you know what they found? They found a play based on Ramayana. Because that is common to all the ASEAN countries, they could not find anything which is common to all the countries. So this is the significance of Ramayana. Now when we talk about the message, I think the message is very profound, and that is the reason Ramayana has survived long history of mankind, all kinds of assaults, all kinds of changes. Now these messages are primarily based on a fight between the good and the bad, the evil and the good. This is the history of mankind. In every society, in every time, you go back thousands of years, or you go back hundreds of years, or a few decades, you will find this story of fight between the good and the bad. And this is the story which is depicted in Ramayana as well. But there is little difference. According to the Hindu scriptures or Indian scriptures, the Ramayana happened in what we call Treta Yuga. Now Treta Yuga has less evil compared to Dwapar Yuga and compared to Kali Yuga. There are four yugas, as you know in our writings. The Satyuga, when generally people are sattvic, the people are good, the evil is practically non-existent at that time. Then comes Treta Yuga, when 1/4 of the good depreciates, disappears, and replaced by evil. That's why it's called Treta, means 1/3, one-third good disappears. And then comes the Dwapar, where 50% of the good disappears and 50% of the good remains. So there's a fight is, more intense. And then comes the Kali Yuga, when there is more and more evil. In fact, 3/4 is evil, only 1/4 is good. So the fight in time of Ramayana between good and evil was not as intense as in the time of Mahabharata, which is in the Dwapar Yuga. And that is why you will find in Mahabharata all kinds of evil forces mentioned in far more detail than in Ramayana. But the story begins with Ramayana. Now, let me cite a few very important messages of Ramayana to start with. You see, the first message of Ramayana is indeed very moving. And I find it very fascinating and very moving. And that is the message of respect to your parents. This is the first message. Not only to parents, but to elders as well, but to parents more specifically. Now, if we go to the story of Ramayana, it was Rama's father, Dasharatha, who committed to one of his wives, Kekai, when the Rama was to be, you know, crowned, he was the eldest son, he had to be crowned. But then the Kekai thought that her son should be crowned, that is Bharat. Why Rama? And she used that opportunity to take two boons which Dasaratha must have committed long time ago. And one of the boons she took, that Rama should be exiled for 14 years in the wilderness, and her son Bharat should be crowned as the next king. Now this was shocking for Dasaratha, of course, but Rama didn't have to follow it. He was not obliged to follow it. It was the promise given by Dasaratha to Kekai. That Rama has nothing to do with it. He had a legitimate claim to the throne. He could have insisted. But no. As per the deep-rooted Indian traditions, we give respect to our parents, their wishes. In fact, Dasaratha didn't want him to go into exile. But Rama realized that what has happened. And he immediately said, yes, I will do it. And that is one thing. This is not only here. This has happened in Mahabharata as well. If you see the story of Satyavati, now, the king at that time in Mahabharata, he wanted to marry Satyavati. He fell in love somehow. She was a woman born in a village, and she was, her father was a fisherman. And when Santanu was in deep trouble, Bhishma, his son, Devrat, that time called Devrat, he followed his father, and he realized what the problem was. And he, in order to fulfill the wish of Shantanu, her father, his father, he committed to himself that he will not marry all his life, so that there is no progeny to claim the throne later on. And he gave all that sacrifice for his father not knowing anything about it. Shantanu didn't know anything about it unless he brought Satyavati home. So that is the commitment. There's another story, as we know, Shravan Kumar and his blind parents, how he took them for Tirth Yatra, for pilgrimage on his own shoulder. And this is, in fact, this story is connected indirectly with Ramayana in a way, because in some of the references, it is said that the death of Dasaratha in the parting of his son, Rama, has its origin in the curse given by the parents of Shravan Kumar to Dasaratha. Because when Dasaratha had gone out in forest for hunting, he heard some sound. He thought it was a deer, and he shot arrow in the direction of that sound. And actually it killed Shravan Kumar, who was taking water from a pond there. And when he realized that a human being has been killed, Dasaratha went there. And then he discovered the entire story, and he felt very sad that the blind parents of Shravan Kumar are without any help anymore. So they gave him a curse at that time, that you will also die in the parting of your son, as we are dying in the parting of our son. So there's a relation there. So this is one basic message, that we respect our parents. Even otherwise, if we look, our birth is because of our parents. If we look at the physical sense, if I'm here, I'm because of my parents. Everybody has that same origin. So this is one lesson which the story of Ramlila, the story of Ramayana, brings out in a very, very profound way. The second message I want to deal with today is about the words you utter, the word you speak. They have a meaning. You should not speak words which you do not mean. Because as I mentioned once, if you analyze the what we call the chakras into the human body. The words which I am uttering now, they come deep down from those chakras. Every time we speak our words, they come down from the soul of our body. And they should carry that meaning. And that is what has been told in Ramayana. There is a doha which says that Raghukul reet sadachali aayi pran jai par bachan na jai. This is one of the dohas in Ramcharitmanas by Tulsidas. But in similar writings exist in Valmiki Ramayana in Sanskrit. That whatever you say, you should mean it and you should work for it. This happened when, it happened in two, three ways. First, it happened with Dasarath, who gave these two boons to Kekai. And whatever she asked, he could have said, no, I can't do it. But he said, I have given my words and I must honor them. And therefore, he decided even to die, but did not want to change what he said. It also happened with Rama, when he was asked by Bharat and others that you don't have to go to the forest. He said, no, I have given my words and whatever may. He said that the sun may lose its shine and the moon may lose its, you know, coolness. And the ocean may dry up, but I cannot dishonor my words. So this is another, in fact, I have brought it here, the some of the Sanskrit slokas from Valmiki Ramayana, which reads it like this. Yeah. This is in Sanskrit. The English version is, beauty may leave the sun. Himavan may become bereft of snow. That is, like Himalaya may become bereft of snow. The ocean may transgress its shores, but I will never violate the promise given by me to my father. These are the precise words in Valmiki Ramayana. So this is the second lesson which we were talking about. Let's talk about the today's world. If you look at this, you know, people don't mean what they say. They don't do what they say. Sometimes you don't know what you do. You know, every single day you meet people, they say, oh, we'll meet tomorrow at 10 o'clock. He doesn't even know what his schedule is. 10 o'clock, he may be on the aircraft going to some other country, and he is telling you, we'll meet tomorrow at 10 o'clock. This has happened, a habit. We say, we don't mean it. This is one thing we must change, that what we say, we should mean it. Otherwise, you don't have to commit anything. Nobody can force you to commit to anything. But when you say something, you commit to something, you mean it, you do it. If you can't do it, say, I'm sorry, I cannot do it. And it is not possible for me. But this is something which we need to learn, because this has become very casual. The whole lifestyle these days has become extremely casual. The third lesson is a very vast lesson in so many ways. It is a lesson of relationships. Overall relationships. We just talked about the parents, but it's a relationship between a brother and another brother. Relationship between the king and the subjects. Relationship between the enemies, the two enemies fighting the war. Relationship between, you know, Swami and Sevak. It is, I don't know how to put it in English. The higher authority and the lower man who is dedicated to him, Swami and Sevak. There's no proper English word which I can find to translate them. So there are a variety of relationships. Not only these, there are many, many more. For example, you look at the behavior of Lakshman and Rama. Now, Lakshman didn't have to go to jungle, but he said, he's my elder brother and I'll accompany him. I'll do whatever is possible. He did everything. He left his wife behind and he looked after Rama and Sita like no one else could do. Nobody can even think about it in today's world. At the same time, look at Bharat. Though Bharat was given the kingdom as per those boons, but Bharat said, no, I cannot do, take it. In fact, he pleaded Rama not to go, but when he did go, he only put Rama's khatau, that is his shoes, on the throne, and based on that, he ruled the country till Rama came back. And as soon as Rama came back, he handed over the kingdom to him. Now, you cannot imagine this kind of behavior in today's world, because we are in Kali Yuga, so we fight for every penny. You forget about the kingdom. Kingdoms are, of course, a big lucrative thing. We even fight for a few dollars here and there. This, the love relationship, the kind of sacrifice which is given in these relationships, it doesn't exist anymore. I think this is a great loss to the humanity. And this is what Ramayana teaches us, how the brothers can respect each other and they can live with each other. Look at another relationship, that is Swami and Sevak, that is Hanuman and Rama. Hanuman did everything possible for Rama. He thought Rama is the Swami, he is the everything almighty for him. And he did everything possible. That is another relationship. Total dedication, total devotion to what he thought was the right thing to do. That's another relationship. Even relationship between what you call Ravana and Rama, the two enemies, but there's a relationship. There are many references there. When Ravana exhausted all the weapons he had, and Rama could have killed him, but he said, no, you go back now, come back tomorrow with all your weapons, and then we'll fight again. And that is the kind of relationship even between the two enemies, the two people who did all kinds of things. But this is a story of relationships in variety of ways. I'm only giving a few examples. There are many more, many, many more relationships. Now, these can be defined with the help of Ramayana in today's world. We will find them very idealistic. But if we can reach closer to them, I think the world would be much, much better. Now I want to go back to the more fundamental issue of Ramayana. This is actually the fundamental to all that which I have spoken just now. It is called what we call the very mission or very purpose of human life. Now that has been defined, and there's a debate between various characters in Ramayana. What is the basic purpose of life? Now, as you know, there are four steps which have been defined in our scriptures. That is dharma, arth, kaam, and moksha. You understand these words? These are not easy to translate, but I will try. Dharma is righteousness. Arth is accumulation of wealth or, you know, getting money power. Kaam is desires, all types of desires which we have, human desires. And then moksha is to get out of this world and link yourself to the super soul, the almighty. How you do that. So these are the four stages of human life which have been defined. There's a debate in Ramayana, also in Mahabharata. Very interesting debate. Now, in the debate, some say that arth is the most important. To earn money is the most important. Because without money, you cannot perform what we call righteousness. You cannot donate people. You cannot show pity to those who need. So this is argument. In fact, in Mahabharata, I remember the Arjuna saying that earth is the most important thing. Only with earth you can fulfill your desires, you can do the dharma, and then you can achieve moksha. This is what Arjuna said to Krishna, his elder brother, Dharmaraj Yudhishthir. And then this Bhima says there, it is the same debate in Ramayana. Bhima said, no, the desires are the most important thing. They are the driving force behind you. They make you work and they make you earn money. And they are the one which will lead you to moksha. So that should be done. And then with all this debate, then somebody else said moksha is the most important thing. That should be the mission of life. Without everything should be done for that purpose. But then final conclusion, which is reached in both the writings, the Ramayana and Mahabharata, is that dharma is the basis of everything. You have to first observe righteousness. If you earn money in a non-righteous way, if you fulfill your desire violating the dharma, it is not right. It's not correct. So dharma is the basis for everything which we do in life. And this is after debating in a profound way, they come to this conclusion. And that is what Valmiki Ramayana says. One of the very important quotes from the Ramayana is, Ahu satyam hi parmah dharma vido jana. The meaning is, those who have knowledge of dharma, they say the truth is the highest dharma. There are many, facets of dharma, but truth is the highest dharma. They also... Now, this is very interesting sloka from Valmiki Ramayana. Dharma dasa prabhavati dharmat prabhavate sukham dharmen labhate dharmam dharma sansar midam jagat. The meaning is, the wealth springs from dharma, from the dharma comes happiness, and one gets everything from dharma. Dharma is the essence of this world. Now, this is a profound debate. These conclusions are reached after a debate. Like we have a debate in a committee room. People come with all kinds of views. Oh, this should be done, that should be done, this is right, this is wrong. Now, these debates have been quoted in these writings, and then they reach the conclusion that dharma is the greatest of all the steps mentioned there. Nothing should be done without adhering to dharma. So this is a very profound message of Ramayana or Ramlila, that dharma must be observed under all circumstances. Now, what is dharma? This is a very big question. It's not easy to define what is dharma. They say the telling the truth is one part of dharma, but there are variety of ways. The best way to assess dharma is to look inside yourself and ask your inner self what is right thing to do in a particular circumstance. Everybody will not get the same answer because we have different structure inside and outside. But you will get an answer. But that answer will be the right answer, provided your soul is clean. It's like what they say, that if there's a dust on the mirror, you will not see your face correctly. So if your soul is covered with all kinds of dust and garbage, then you won't get the right answer from there. So you have to keep your soul pure, and then you will get a right answer, and that will be your dharma. The dharma is an individual concept. It is not, there are certain guidelines which are followed, but then it is an individual concept. This basic guidelines which include in dharma is the truth, that is the one. Then daya, that is pity, to have compassion for the others. to keep control over senses, daman, that is another one. Then daan, that is to donate to the poor people, needy people, money. You know, these are some of the facets of dharma. Then dharma also means a greater good of the society. When you are in a position of a king where thousands of people are involved, not your family alone, then you have to take into account the greater good of the masses, not the good of yourself or the family alone. So that is, we call it Rajdharma, a separate topic altogether. So there are variety of debates on dharma, but fundamentally the basic human values emanate, they come out from dharma. And that is what we are missing today in the world. So it is extremely important that the message of Ramlila reaches there. Now, I can of course speak on many other important messages of Ramayana, but I want to go back a little bit in the history briefly of your country. If you look at the people who came from 1845 onwards here, imagine in that time you come by these boats, 100 days on the ship, the so-called, you know, poor boat, and you land up in a place where nobody knows you. You can't speak language, your clothing are different, your food is different, your music is different, you can do nothing. How do you live? Now that is where the story of Ramayana came to support the people who came from India here. As I understand from many people who have done research on this, that this was the first thing which gave physical, moral, and, you know, what you call inner support to the people who came crossing Kalapani, Saat Samudra Paar to this part of the world. So this is again the story of Ramlila, Ramayana, which gave them the support. How did it give support? Because it has strength. It has the character. The character stands out. If there's no character, it cannot stand out. You put the gold anywhere in all kinds of dirt, ultimately when it comes out, it will shine. Whatever you do with it, it doesn't matter. The same thing happens with Ramayana, because it's a gold of human civilization, human values. You take it anywhere, put it anywhere, ultimately it will come out, the good will come out of it. And that's where the whole story started in this part of the world. And I pay tribute to you and your ancestors for bringing this great story in this part of the world, far away from India. And in fact, today you are doing extremely well in reviving the story of Ramlila and Ramayana in this country. I have seen some places where Ramlila is performed, and I believe there are about 40 places every year where Ramlila is celebrated. We have the members of the Ramlila Council present here today. They know much more about it, but it has been a fascinating story, how you translated it into English and then performed it from generations. So I would like to thank you on that, and also like to make a point that the strength of Ramayana is so deep that it worked as a support for the people who were completely lost, who came here after 1845. And it continues to support. If you lose these threads, if you lose these basic pillars of life, I think we can completely lose ourselves. So we have to keep these pillars available for the future generation, for our progeny, so that they can continue to navigate themselves with the support of these kind of values. This is not Ramlila, but the values contained in it. Now, briefly about Leela, because there was some reference, Pandita mentioned Leela. Now, Leela is, as you know, a very profound word. Leela is like something which is staged. It is performed deliberately. It is not the natural way. It's when the good comes in the form of human being, as I mentioned, as this the sloka in chapter 4 of Bhagavad Gita. He performs a leela. He is not a human being in the normal sense as we are. But he performs a leela. And that is the point I want to make very strongly today. Because the other day I was in one of the temples here. Sometimes a question arises in our mind that if Rama was God or Krishna was God, why didn't he know everything that Sita will be kidnapped and, you know, this will happen, and why did he have to take help from, you know, Hanuman and Sugriv and others to conquer? Why did he have to find where Sita has disappeared? He would have known. He is almighty. He is supreme. He knows everything. Why did he have to do all this? Now, this is a question. Because the supreme almighty knows everything. We say that Rama is that which is ghat ghat mein ram raha. You know, this is some of the bhajans which you would listen, which is prevalent in every single particle of this universe. And the Almighty knows everything. But when he is coming in the form of human being here, he is performing a leela. He is not God in that sense. He is a human being. He has come with a mission and he wants to behave like a human being. Because the laws of human being have been set by him. He cannot, what you call, transgress those laws. If he transgresses those laws, others will do the same thing. For example, he has given a property to the sun to shine. He cannot withdraw that property. Even if he has come in the form of human being on this earth. He does not want to do it because that means a destruction of the creation, destruction of the entire natural system of righteousness. You cannot transgress the basic laws of nature because those laws have been set by him. There are references in Ramayana on this, why he couldn't do it, because he could not transgress. He did not want to transgress. He can't set a wrong example for the humanity. So when Rama comes on the earth, or Krishna comes, or, you know, the God comes in any other form and name at some stage later, he only performs a leela because he has his purpose is to destroy the evil, to re-establish the righteousness, to destroy the evil. And that is what Rama had to perform, that leela. And we are performing that leela in a different way now. We are performing that leela, why? Because that leela, that theater, that drama, contains the essence of that message which we want to convey to our younger generation, to the new generation. Because if you tell them to read the story, they will not get the sense of it. But if you perform it on the stage, it dramatically changes the perception and knowledge of the person who is looking at it. And that is why we perform leela, whether it's Ram leela or Krishna leela, is a very ancient tradition of teaching, of transmitting the knowledge through oral traditions. This is a very, very old, ancient tradition of India. Most of our knowledge has been transmitted through this process. And that is why the word leela is extremely important, because firstly, it has a different connotation when the good comes in the form of human being on this earth to destroy the evil. That is leela. Like somebody goes and performs in Shakespeare's play. Now for 3 hours, he is not like, I, Gauri Shankar, go and perform, say, some role in Shakespeare's play. So it, for 3 years, I'm not Gauri Shankar, I'm called that. But when I return back, I'm Gauri Shankar, the original form. So the same thing happens with the Almighty. When he's here for a duration, he is performing that role as re-establishing the good over evil. So that is what a Leela is extremely important in that sense. And second sense, as I mentioned, is to transmit this knowledge from one generation to another generation, because the drama, theater, dance is far more attractive for the people to understand than through the reading of the scriptures and the books. So these are some of the issues I thought I will deal with today. I don't know how much time they will allow me, but I want to cover one more issue before I end my talk today. That is concerning my profession, diplomacy. If we go back in time, you will find that Hanuman was the first diplomat in the history of mankind. He went as Dut, Ram Dut. He went as, you know, a messenger of Rama to the court of Ravana, that please free Sita, without otherwise you will end up in a war. And he had that immunity, because the Duts have that immunity, the diplomats have that immunity. So he could destroy some part of Lanka at that time when he went as diplomat, and they could not do anything against him. You see, the laws of diplomacy were followed even that time. This is the oldest written, record in the human history about a diplomat. Then, of course, we have diplomatic, lot of missions in Mahabharata, when, in fact, Krishna himself went as a diplomat to the court of Dhritarashtra, taking the message of Pandava. So these are other examples which teach you even the diplomacy. The field which is nobody can think about is enshrined in Ramayana. Diplomacy, it's enshrined there. And the last point I would like to touch is the evil part of it. You know, there's a fight of good and evil everywhere. Now, Rama is a symbol of good and Ravana is the symbol of evil. Now, Ravana was a very learned man too. He had great knowledge and he had tremendous boons from Lord Shiva. And his knowledge was not less. In fact, if you remember, after he was killed, not killed, but he was completely wounded, Rama sent Lakshmana to Ravana to ask him about his wisdom. And that is a very profound wisdom he gives at that time. So, though he was an evil person, he was also a learned person. He was evil in certain ways. He was evil, why? Because he had lust. He had arrogance. Arrogance, lust, greed. These were the three important facets of his personality which made him evil. He had lust for Sita. He fell for the beauty of Sita and he kidnapped her. That was part of his lust. He was greedy because he wanted to acquire more and more wealth. He punished his own brothers, own family members. If you look at this history of Vivikshan, if you look at the history of some of other members of his family, that was because of the greed. And then arrogance. He thought nobody can destroy him, nobody can kill him. He had those kind of boons from Lord Shiva. So he became extremely arrogant. So these were the facets which actually added to the evil part of Ravana. On the other hand, if you look at Rama, he was very humble. He had no pretense, no arrogance at all. He would go with anybody. He never treated himself as a king. He was very compassionate to others, Even in the worst circumstances, he will help others. He had so much strength, but he was never proud or arrogant of it. So these are the, what you call, opposite sides, opposite facets of human life. But one lesson we can draw that arrogance, greed and lust, they are destructive forces, these are the evil forces, and we should try to reduce them as much as we can. This is the last lesson I would mention today. And that is why we call Rama, actually Rama was called Maryada Purusottam. That is the best of the human being with all what you call ideal behavior in all circumstances, an ideal son, an ideal brother, and ideal king, and ideal husband, and you know, all those things were, that is what called Maryada Purusottam Ram. That is how it was defined. So the Rama remains as what you call the most ideal human being in the history of mankind, and his behavior is worth emulating by each one of us. His life, his behavior is the message, is the lesson for each one of us. So with these words, I would like to just recite one more sloka which ends up this talk of today, and which defines what is evil and what is good. The sloka reads like this in Sanskrit. Vidya vivadai dhanam madai shakti paresham parpidinai khalasya sadho viprit metat jnanai danai charakshanai. Now this is a fight of the evil and the good. Khalasya sadho viprit metat. Khal is a wicked person, an evil person. Sadho is a good person, a man with noble thoughts, noble vision. What is the difference between the two? Vidya vivada. If the wicked person gets knowledge, he uses it to create unnecessary debate. If he gets wealth, dhanam madai, he becomes arrogant. Mad is even beyond arrogance, you know. He becomes arrogant. Shakti paresham par. If he gets power, Parisham parpidina, he uses it to torture others, to create problem for others. And if a good person gets the same thing, jnanai danai charakshanai. If a good person gets knowledge, he uses it to enhance the knowledge of others. If he gets wealth, he donates it to the poor and the needy. And if he gets power, he uses it to protect the weak. So this is the difference between the good and the evil. Thank you very much.